Hello everyone. So next unit that we'll be starting is oils, fats and lipids. This is a part of CHORT 3.2 and it is unit 4 in your paper number 2. So what are lipids? They are organic compounds found in living organisms that are soluble in non-polar organic solvents. Now these non-polar organic solvents can be diethyl ether, it can be chloromethane, it can be DCM. Because it is lipids, lipos meaning it is fat. Lipids are generally defined by their physical operation that we use to isolate them. That is, if the lipid is coming from a fat, then it is called as triacyl glycerol system. If it is coming from a menthol like of system, then it has been isolated from a terpenoid system. It can also be from a vitamin A system, which again is a terpenoid system. Cholesterol like system can be considered as a steroid system, and there is also a system called as lecithin system, which is going to speak about a phosphatide system. Now where can we see these occurrence and composition of the fats? Now fats are the main constituents of the storage fat cells in animals and plants and are one of the important food reserves of the organism. Obviously, apart from the glucose and the carbohydrate system, the next type of reservation that we observe is it is the fats which will be reserved in the organism and it is stored in the liver. We can extract the animal or vegetable fats. Now these can be liquid fats. Now when they are said to be liquid fats, then they are called as oils. Example can be a corn oil and it can be a palm oil system. Now what is a chemical composition? The next concept is what is a chemical composition? Chemically, these fats are carboxylic esters derived from single alcohol. Now, which is the type of alcohol? That is glycerol system. The structure of the glycerol is OH, CH2, CH2, CHOH, CH2OH, and it is known as glyceride system. Specifically, they are triacyl glycerol systems. Now each fat is made up of glycerides derived from many different triacyl glycerols. Now they are also carboxylic acids. Now what is the meaning of triacyl system? That means it is being converted to a respective ester. Now we speak them as a fatty acid system. Now acid system has been converted to its respective ester system over here. Now here CH2OH system, which may be an alcoholic system, it has been converted to its respective ester. Now hence this is called as a triacyl glycerol system, or it is also called as a glyceride system. Now here R, R dash and R double dash can be same or they can be different from one another. The proportions of various acids may vary from fat to fat. That means we can change R, R1, R2, so on and so forth. Each fat has its characteristics composition, which does not differ very much from sample to sample. That means they do not differ much in the characterization. That is because they are derived from the glyceride system only. They are not derived from any other type of the fatty acids. But there are few exceptions also. All the fatty acids are straight chain compounds. They range from 3 to 18 carbons except C3 and C5. Now these are odd number carbons. Generally the fatty acids, they are present in an even number system, but these are odd number system and they are said to be an exceptions. Now these are the only acids containing an even number of carbons that are present in substantial amounts. That means generally in the naturally occurring systems, it is always seen that there are even carbon atoms that are present. Now these even numbers are natural because they are result of the biosynthesis of the fats. The molecules are built up of two carbons at a time. That means the molecules are built up at two carbons at a time from acetate units. Now acetate units, every time it is going to add two carbon atoms. Hence generally the fatty acids which are being available in the natural system, they always have an even number of system. But there are one or two exceptions, that is C3 and C5 system. Now there may be many examples. Few examples are oleic acid, and it is an unsaturated acid. Linoleic acid, again it is an unsaturated acid. Generally the fatty acid systems that we see, they may be saturated or they may be unsaturated system. Unsaturated system, these two are the examples. The next concept that we observe in this oils and fats is called as hydrogenation. Now what is an hydrogenation? We just now saw that there is a presence of a unsaturated system, that means presence of a double bond, for example oleic acid and linoleic acid. Now in an hydrogenation system is, we convert those double bond system into a single bond system, that means we just reduce the double bond into a single bond system. So hydrogenation of some of the double bonds in such cheap fats such as cottonseed oil, corn oil, it converts these liquids into solids having a consistency compared to that of lard or butter. Now Dalda is one kind of example where we just convert the liquid or the oil into its solid fat system. Now this hardening of oils is the basis of an important industry that produces cooking fats. Now it is a very important industry that we try to discuss over here, that is the industry of cooking fats. That means they convert the cheap oils into consistency of butter. Now for a common example that we see is the Dalda system. Definitely it is not good for health, but what they try to do is they can store it for a longer period. Hence what they do is they convert the double bond system into a single bond system. Now hydrogenation of double bonds, it takes place under mild conditions. Nickel is a catalyst over there, which is going to act as a temperature at a temperature of 175 to 190 degrees. That hydrogenolysis of the ester linkage does not occur. Now only hydrogenation takes place in the presence of nickel, but hydrogenolysis doesn't take place. About the hydrogenolysis we will talk further. Now what is hydrogenation? Hydrogenation not only changes the physical property of a fat, but also, this is more important, it changes the chemical properties also. A hydrogenated fat becomes rancid much less and is readily available than does a non-hydrogenated fat. Now what happens is, because in the naturally occurring system there is a presence of double bond system, now they can be attacked by atmospheric oxygen, and once they get attacked by the atmospheric oxygen they get degraded. So with the help of hydrogenation, what we are trying to do is we are trying to convert this double bond system into a single bond system. Now when this conversion takes place, now there is no chance of oxygen to attack. If there is no chance of oxygen to attack, then there is no question of the rancidity of the system. That means there will not be much rancidity. No attack of the atmospheric oxygen, meaning that we can store this particular fat for a longer period. Now this is the obvious use of the hydrogenation system. So what happens in this procedure? There is an unsaturated fat that we make use. In the presence of nickel, the hydrogenation takes place, double bond gets converted to a single bond. Now a hydrogenated fat becomes rancid much less readily than a non-hydrogenated fat. Now when I compare these two systems, this will take more time to get degraded and become rancid. That means attack of the atmospheric oxygen on this particular system is very very slow. Whereas because there is a presence of a double bond over here, attack of atmospheric oxygen takes place and then it gets degraded easily. Now, what is the meaning of rancidity? Rancidity is due to the presence of volatile, bad smelling acids and aldehydes. That means at this particular position, if I am adding oxygen, they can either give me a bad smelling acid system or they can give me an aldehydic system due to oxidation reaction. And once the oxidation takes place, that means this fat or oil is not suitable for the consumption. Now, these compounds, they result from an attack by oxygen at a relative allylic position in the fat molecules. That means there should be some allylic position in the fat molecules where the oxygen will go and attack, and in turn it is going to give me fatty acids or it is going to give me certain aldehydes which are bad smelling in the system. Now, hydrogenation, what does hydrogenation do in this situation? Hydrogenation, it actually slows down the development of rancidity. That means the oxygen cannot attack the double bond. In turn, the oil can be stored for a longer period, because presumably by decreasing the number of double bonds, where does the oxygen actually attack over here? It has to attack the double bond. If I just reduce the double bond, then that means it gets converted to a single bond, and hence the number of allylic position also gets decreased. In turn, there would be less rancidity. That means we can store the oil for a longer period of time. Now, in the presence of hydrogenation catalyst, what happens? Unsaturated compounds undergo not only hydrogenation but also isomerization. That means there will be a shift of double bonds or stereochemical transformation. It affects the physical and chemical properties. That means at once we can add one hydrogen in the system. If I am adding some hydrogens into the double bond system, there may be shift of the double bond systems through an allylic position. This shift of the double bond system, it will change the physical and chemical properties of the fat that we are looking into. The next system is, we are trying to understand what is a hydrogenation. Hydrogenation is nothing but it is hardening of oils. That means we are converting the double bond system into a single bond system. The hydrogenation reaction must be carefully controlled. This is because I do not want to reduce all the double bonds. I want to control the reduction of the double bonds, because if I try to reduce all the double bonds in the system, then I am going to get a hard fat, which is not a useful fat. So we need to control the addition of hydrogen so that hydrogenation takes place and we can control the rancidity of the system. In this process, I should not look for reducing all the double bonds, instead the double bonds which are susceptible to the rancidity. Now, which are the double bonds which are susceptible to the rancidity? The extreme end double bonds, they are more susceptible to the rancidity. That means attack of the atmospheric oxygen. So these need to be reduced by the hydrogen in the presence of platinum. But the middle double bond, which is highly substituted double bond, it does not easily get rancid or does not easily be attacked by the oxygen. In turn, what will happen is the terminal double bonds have to be reduced, whereas the middle double bond is left so that I do not get a hard fat. Instead, I get a dalda like of structure or a butter like of texture. So this is how we need to control hydrogenation. If we do not control hydrogenation, we are going to get a hard fat, which is of no use in the cooking industry. Now, till this point, we were speaking about rancidity. So what is this actual rancidity? Rancidity is nothing but here rancid mechanism. Rancidity is nothing but attack of a free radical system from the atmosphere onto the fatty acid system, so that the fatty acid gets degraded or it is going to give me bad smelling compounds. So that is called as rancidity. The rancidity rancid oils are not fit for consumption, whereas the oils which are fit for consumption are, they should not be rancid. That means they should not have any bad smelling compounds. So let us look at the rancidity and its mechanism. Now let us see that there is a presence of a double bond over here, there is a presence of a double bond. Now in between these two double bonds, there is an active methylene group. Now this is called as allylic position of these two double bonds. Now from an active methylene group, a radical like X dash. Now this radical can be anything which can be generated from an atmosphere. It can be an oxygen radical or any kind of radical. This will abstract the methylene proton system. In turn, now there is a radical which gets introduced at this particular position. Now there will be resonance contributors with the isolated double bond. Now the radical will pick up this HX and it will be eliminated out. But there is a new radical which gets introduced in this long chain system. This radical now will have a resonance contributor system. That means these will resonate so that the double bonds will have various resonating contributor structures with the conjugated double bonds. Now what will happen is, these are the isolated bonds, whereas once there is a resonance contributed, then resonant contributed with the conjugated double bonds will be present. In turn, this radical will be moved to a terminal position. Now, once this radical moves to a terminal position, now the oxygen will attack. That means the atmospheric oxygen will attack on this radical and we get a peroxy radical system. The atmospheric oxygen will attack on this radical and we get a peroxy radical. Now, this peroxy radical will help in the propagation. This peroxy radical will attack the second molecule of a fatty acid, so that there is this particular peroxy radical will abstract this methylene proton and this gets converted into an alkyl hydroperoxide system. Now this is again a bad smelling compound and a new radical is generated on the second fatty acid system. In this way the rancidity mechanism takes place. So how can we conclude the rancidity mechanism? A free radical first attacks the methylene proton system and abstract the proton. This in turn will be released out as HX. In the long chain fatty acid system, there is a new free radical which has been introduced. Now this new free radical which gets introduced now will have resonant contributed with an isolated double bond. Now these isolated double bond, because of the resonance contributor system, they get converted into a conjugated double bond system and the free radical gets shifted at the terminal position. Once the free radical gets shifted at the terminal position, now oxygen which is present in the atmosphere attacks the free radical system. It is going to give me a peroxy radical. Now this peroxy radical, it helps in the further propagation. Peroxy radical attacks the second molecule of a fatty acid. Now this peroxy radical will abstract the proton from the active methylene group and then it gets converted into an alkyl hydroperoxide, which is a bad smelling system. In turn, a new free radical gets introduced and hence the rancidity mechanism goes on continuing. In turn, now this is going to degrade my whole fatty acid systems. Now, what exactly has been happened, we'll be again watching it. Polyunsaturated fatty acids and oils are easily oxidized by oxygen by means of a radical chain reaction. That is what we have seen. In an initiation, a radical removes a hydrogen from a methylene group that is flanked by two double bonds. That is what we have seen. It is easily removed because the resulting radical is resonance stabilized by both the double bonds. That means we are getting a resonating contributors. The resulting radical leads reaction reacts with an oxygen to give a peroxy radical with a conjugated double bond. So we get a conjugated double bond. Now this peroxy radical removes a hydrogen from a methylene group of another molecule of a fatty acid, forming an alkyl hydroperoxide. So what we get? An alkyl hydroperoxide. The propagating steps are repeated over and over again. The reaction of fatty acids with oxygen causes them to become rancid. So that means rancidity is nothing but it is like a degradation of the oils, leading to very much bad smelling systems. Now that is the mechanism of the rancidity. The next concept is called as drying oils. Now drying oils are very very important in terms of varnishes and paints. That means they should be proper dried, so that now varnish that we put on our furniture or the paints that we put on the walls, these needs to be dried properly. They need to form a coating layer so that it is a chemical reaction between that particular component on which we are going to paint the system. Now an example for these drying oils is linseed oil and tung oil. Now these are very very important in terms of the high content of their glycerides. They are derived from acid containing 2 or 3 double bonds. Now linseed oil and tung oil are important for the industries of paints and varnishes. Now these are called as drying oils because they are used in paints and varnishes. Now the drying of the paint does not simply involve evaporation of a solvent, but it is a chemical reaction in which a tough organic film is formed. That means of course the compound needs to be dissolved in a solvent, but just not the evaporation that takes place, but it has to also form a tough organic film. Now film is brought about by the polymerization of the unsaturated oils. What happens exactly is the unsaturated oils, they get polymerized and they are brought by the presence of the atmospheric oxygen. Atmospheric oxygen reacts with this linseed oil and the tung oil so that there is a formation of an organic layer and they get dried. Now this is generally seen in your painting industry and varnishes industry. The next concept from hydrogenation is now the focus will be hydrogenolysis. What is hydrogenation? Hydrogenation, we saw that double bond getting converted to a single bond. That means liquid oil getting converted to a solid fatty-like system. But hydrogenolysis is called as cleavage of a hydrogen of an ester. It requires more severe conditions than simple hydrogenation to a carbon-carbon double bond. Now easy is what? Addition of hydrogen across a carbon-carbon double bond. But if I want to cleave a hydrogen from an ester group, that means that particular system is called as hydrogenolysis. We require high pressures and elevated temperatures and sometimes catalyst. Now a common catalyst that they make use is copper chromide system, which is the composition COOCuCr2O4. Now this is a catalyst which is used in the hydrogenolysis. Now what exactly is a hydrogenolysis? Now let us take an example of methyl laurate, that is methyl dodecanoate. Now here it is an ester of the fatty acid. In the presence of hydrogen and copper chromide system at 150 degrees and 5000 lb, that means so much pressure, this ester is getting converted to respective alcohol. That means ester is getting reduced to an alcohol and we get an methyl alcohol which gets reduced. So methyl dodecanoate is getting converted to 1-dodecanoil or lauryl alcohol. That means what we are doing here is we are trying to cleave the hydrogenic system from an ester and then we are trying to get an alcohol from the ester and the respective two alcohol systems have been formed. How is generally ester formed? Ester is formed by the presence of a carboxylic acid which reacts with an alcohol. But what we are trying to do here is we are trying to introduce an hydrogen so that these two systems, they are getting converted to two different alcoholic systems only. So that procedure is called as hydrogenolysis. Now that gets carried in the presence of a copper chromide system. It's a very difficult reaction because it requires higher temperature and also it requires higher pressure. The next concept is called as hydrolysis of fats. Now hydrolysis of glyceride system. Basically, hydrolysis yields salts of carboxylic acids and glycerol system. So this is a triglyceride system. When I react it with NaOH, glycerol is released and we get a soap. So what happens here is there is a release of the alcohol system, that is a triglycerol system. In turn, there is an addition of sodium and then we get a soap. Now, ordinary soap today is simply a mixture of sodium salts of long chain fatty acids. So what is a soap? It is a mixture of sodium salts of long chain fatty acids. It is a mixture because the fat from which it is made is a mixture for washing and mixture just as a good as a single pure salt. The dependent on whether it is R, R dash and R double dash are same or different, it is going to give me a mixture or it is going to give me one single pure salt. Now this is how the manufacturing of the soap takes place. Then how is this procedure takes place or method of processing of the soap? If there is an addition of an olive oil, that means we get a castile soap. If there is an addition of an alcohol, then we get a transparent soap. That means in the triglyceride system only, apart from adding your sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide, if along with I am adding olive oil, then it is called as castile soap. I am adding some alcohol, then we get a transparent soap. So if there is some air that is bubbled out in that particular system, then it will make the soap to float. Now generally perfumes, dyes and germicides can also be added to this particular processing so that we get different soaps. Now if it is a potassium salt, then the soap is called as soft soap. If it is a sodium salt, then it is called as hard soap. Potassium salts are your toilet soaps, whereas sodium salt soaps are your detergent kinds of soap. If we add sodium chloride to that particular system, then the whole soap will get precipitated. Now, we want to analyze oils and fats. So there are certain values through which we can analyze the oils and fats. One such value is called as saponification value. Now, this is nothing but base promoted hydrolysis of ester. Now what we do in this saponification value is we reflux the ester in the presence of base and water, we get its respective sodium carboxylate and an alcohol. Now this carboxylate ion is very unreactive towards nucleophilic substitution because it is negatively charged. Obviously the lone pair of electrons will be moving between these two oxygen and hence it is very much unreactive towards any kind of nucleophilic substitution. Base promoted hydrolysis of ester as a result is an essentially irreversible reaction. Once the ester reacts with NaOH, we cannot do a reversible reaction. Because on this particular system, we cannot add any next nucleophile. The mechanism is interesting in this particular system. The mechanism for a base promoted hydrolysis of an ester involves a nucleophilic addition elimination at an acyl carbon. So at an acyl carbon, there is a nucleophilic addition and elimination. So let us see what is that particular mechanism. Now let us say that there is an ester system. Now this is an ester. RCOOR dash is an ester system attacked by a base. Lone pair of electrons, the negative charge on this nucleophile, it will attack the carbonyl carbon. This is a slow reaction. That means this is a rate determining step. Once it attacks on the carbonyl carbon, there is a tetrahedral intermediate which expels an alkoxide ion. So this tetrahedral intermediate, once the electrons they move back to get me a carbonyl carbon, it will release an alkoxide ion. So what has happened here is there is a release of an alkoxide ion. But this alkoxide ion, it can abstract this particular proton. This will release me an alcohol in the process, and it is going to give me an acyl oxygen system, or it is going to give me a carboxylate system. Now this transfer of the proton to the products of the reaction. So this alkoxide ion, it abstracts this proton, in turn it is going to give me a carboxylate system. So let us see the mechanism once again. Nucleophile attacks the carbonyl carbon. This is a slow rate determining step. This in turn will give me a tetrahedral intermediate. Once this lone pair of electrons, they travel back to get me a carbonyl carbon, it is going to expel an alkoxide system, and this alkoxide system is released like the RO dash system, RO negatively charged. This negatively charged oxygen can abstract the proton, so that it is going to give me a carboxylate anion system and an alcohol gets reduced. What is the evidence for this particular system is isotopically labeled oxygen. Either of the oxygens are isotopically labeled, in turn we understand that there is a cleavage that has taken place. The next concept is called as saponification of triacyl glycerol systems. Now triacyl glycerol system, what we try to do is we take up an ester. It reacts with 3 moles of NaOH system. It is going to give me a glycerol, and there will be sodium carboxylate. Now this particular system is called as SOAP system. What we are trying to do is we are trying to react the triacyl glyceride system, and we get a sodium carboxylate, we get a SOAP system. The salts of long chain carboxylic acids are soap. That means we get various type of either mixed soap or they can be pure soap system, dependent on R, R dash and R double dash system. And this saponification reaction is way many soaps are manufactured. That means the manufacturing of the soap is by this procedure only. The glycerides, they are treated with NaOH or KOH to give me the mixture of the soap. So we want to understand what is a saponification value. Now functional derivatives of carboxylic acids are recognized by their hydrolysis under more or less vigorous condition to carboxylic acid. Just which kind of derivative it is indicated by other products of the hydrolysis. That means what has happened in the hydrolysis, what is the product that we get in the hydrolysis is being observed through a saponification value. Now, identification of the proof of the structure involves the identification of the proof of the structure. It involves the carboxylic acid formed upon the hydrolysis. In case of an ester, the alcohol that is obtained is also identified. So if we have started with the fatty acid system only, if there is a presence of a carboxylic acid, what we try to understand is the what is the type of the carboxylic acid which was formed. But if we have started from an ester, then what is the type of alcohol that is obtained, that gets identified. If an ester is hydrolyzed in a known amount of base, that means we try to add more base, that means basically we are trying to synthesize a soap like of system. The amount of base used up can be measured and used to give the saponification equivalent. The equivalent weight of an ester, which is similar to the neutralization equivalent of an acid. So what we try to do here is we take up an ester, react with equivalent of a base so that I get an alcohol system and I get a carboxylate system over here. So how much amount of the base is being picked up that by that particular ester system can be calculated. The next concept is called as waxes. Now these are esters. They are formed from long chain carboxylic acid and long chain alcohol system. An example can be a beeswax. 16 carbon carboxylic acid component and a 30 carbon alcohol component. Now in an ester system, one part is an acid system, the other part is an alcohol system. In a beeswax, 16 carbon is a carboxylic acid system and 30 carbon is an alcohol component. It is a wax through which we get this, and it is a material of a honeycomb. There is another example which is called as carnauba wax, which is also called as hard wax. Because of its high molecular weight, it is 32 carbon carboxylic acid plus 34 carbon alcohol component, used in car waxes, floor polishes, etc. Now the structure of beeswax is this. That means it is a component of an ester. So acid is 16 carbon carboxylic content, whereas an alcohol is a 30 carbon alcohol component. Carnauba wax is the 32 carbon carboxylic acid and 34 carbon alcohol component. So these are useful, like beeswax is useful in various industries, and carnauba wax is used in floor polishes and waxes, like for example the shoe polishes and so on and so forth. So what we try to understand next is, we want to try to understand the saponification value. So saponification value is, it is the number of milligrams of KOH required completely to saponify 1 gram of oil or fat. The saponification value can be determined by refluxing a known amount of the sample with excess of standard alcoholic potash solution and then titrating the unused alkali against a standard acid solution. Now what we try to do over here is, we take up the fat system and to that we add excess of alcoholic potash, potassium hydroxide. Now this potassium hydroxide is now observed that 1 gram of oil or fat that is required so that the whole fatty acid system gets neutralized. Now we are knowing the fixed amount of the sample, we know how much we have to add excess of the alkali to the system. So whatever excess alkali is remained in the solution, that gets titrated against the acid, by which we get a saponification system. Now we know that each molecule of fat, regardless of its size, it requires 3 molecules of KOH to saponify it. It is evident that saponification number really indicates the number of fat molecules per gram of the fat. The larger the fat molecule, the fewer the number will be per gram fat. That means if there is a larger fat molecule, there will be fewer per gram fat. The saponification number therefore becomes a measure of the size of the fat molecule, or more specifically the size or molecular weight of the fatty acids in the fat. So what we understand from a saponification value is the molecular weight. That means how much of the KOH has been utilized. Basically 3 moles of KOH is first utilized. So excess how much has been utilized, and what is left over, it gets titrated with the standard acid. In turn, the value that we get gives me a saponification number or the saponification value. Saponification value speaks about the molecular weight of that particular fatty acid. A high saponification number indicates low molecular weight. That means if the saponification number is more, that means the fatty acid is having a low molecular weight. Now for example, if I take a butter, the saponification value is 227. If we take a butter, the saponification value is 227. In case of lard oil, the saponification value is 197. What does it say? Higher the saponification value, lower is the molecular weight of the fat. So what we are trying to understand here, that means butter has got low molecular weight, whereas lard oil has got higher molecular weight. So dependent on this particular value, we try to understand the molecular weight based on the saponification value. So how do we do this experimentally? Determination of the saponification number. What is the principle of saponification? On refluxing with alkali, triacyl glycerols, that is fatty acid esters, are hydrolyzed to give glycerol and potassium salts of fatty acids. Such process is known as saponification. So what we do is we try to reflux the triacyl glycerol with an alkali and we get potassium salts. Now this process is called as saponification. The saponification equation is shown below. So what we do, we take up triacyl glycerides, that means fat. It reacts with 3 moles of KOH and then there is a saponification, that means heat plus water, we get glycerol plus we get a soap. That means because I have made use of a potassium, I should get a potassium salt. The saponification value is the number of milligrams of KOH. Saponification value is the number of milligram of KOH required to neutralize the fatty acids resulting from the complete hydrolysis of 1 gram of the fat. That means 1 gram of the fat, how many moles of KOH is required, that gets calculated. The saponification value gives an indication of the nature of the fatty acid constituent of the fats. Such, it depends on an average molecular weight of the fatty acids and the constituent of the fat. The greater the molecular weight, the longer chain the carbon chain. That means the smaller the number of fatty acids is liberated per gram of fat hydrolyzed, therefore the smaller is the saponification number and vice versa. That means higher the saponification value, lower molecular weight. Higher the saponification value, lower molecular weight. Whereas lower the saponification value, higher molecular weight that we do. This also you do in your third semester practicals. Now, materials that we required is, we require fats. It can be any kind of fat. It is a fat solvent, that is we require ethanol and ether. We require alcoholic KOH, that is 0.5 mole per liter. So what are the other components that we require? We require a reflux condenser, boiling water bath, phenolphthalein indicator, HCl, which is again 0.5 mole per liter, burettes we require, and conical flask. So what is the procedure that we follow? Accurately, we weigh 1 gram of fat in a small beaker and dissolve it in about 3 ml of the fat solvent. What is the solvent? Ethanol plus ether. Quantitatively, transfer the contents of the beaker to 250 ml conical flask by rinsing the beaker 3 times with further millimeters of the solvent. That means we add excess of the solvent. Then we add 25 ml of alcoholic KOH and attach to reflux condenser. Now in this way we also set another set, that is set another reflux condenser as blank with everything except the fat. So what we do in a second set, we add everything, we just add KOH to the system and we just keep it for heating. Whereas in the first set what we do, we have added fat. Now this second set is called as blank set, whereas this first set is called as main set. Now these are heated on a boiling water bath for 30 minutes. Then it is left to cool at room temperature and it is titrated against 0.5 mole per liter HCl and we add phenolphthalein as an indicator until the pink color persists. Record the readings as TML for the test and BML for the blank. So test is what, where we have added fat, and B is what, where we have added the blank system. Now what we do, the calculation, the difference between the blank and the test, that means what is the reading of the difference between blank and test, the readings gives the number of milliliters of KOH required to saponify 1 gram of the fat. So what is the formula that we make use? 1 ml, that is 0.5 N HCl, is equal to 28.05 milligram KOH. So B minus T, that is blank minus test. What is this 28.05? Potassium is 19, oxygen is 8, and your hydrogen is 1. That is the atomic number, and hence we get 28.5. So saponification value is equal to blank minus test burette reading into 28.5 divided by weight of the fat, 1 gram. So much milligram of KOH. So what is the milligram of KOH which has been utilized? Now this is going to give me saponification value. So if the saponification value is higher, that means it is going to give me a low molecular weight of the fat. If it is lower saponification value, that means it is a higher molecular weight of the fat. So this is how we do a saponification number or saponification value. Saponification value generally speaks about the molecular weight of that particular fatty acids. Thank you.